Good evening and welcome to this edition of The Checkpoint. My name is Nicholas Wasaja. Today we are going to be talking environmental degradation in Uganda. You are aware that many of our livelihoods intimately depend on the environment for subsistence and commercial production because we are a largely agrarian society. Unfortunately, we are losing the environment to human activities and sometimes forces beyond our control. To discuss how we can mitigate these challenges and moving forward is the Executive Director, National Environment Management Authority, Dr. Tom Okrut. Doctor, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Welcome. Thank you, Tom.
Doctor, one of the issues that has recently come out has been whether the question on whether Uganda has adequate policy and legislation to mitigate environmental degradation.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Nicholas. I think if you look at the stock of the policy frameworks, policies and legislative frameworks in the country, they are adequate, robust, and we may not need new ones that are additional. So they are there, and they are sufficient to, if applied fully, there will be sufficient deal with the issues at hand. The issue is that some of the application side of the law to the intended end, sometimes is where the weaknesses are. So we observe what we observe because of that. But otherwise, policy framework, legal framework, I think they are sufficient.
If policy framework and legal framework is sufficient, then where are the loopholes? Why is it that they are not being implemented? Well, these days we hear the president and the government being very emphatic on encroachers of the environment. But my assumption is that these policies and legislation have been there for quite some time. Why now? Why aren't we implementing them?
Not policies and the laws have been implemented, but to varying extent, okay? And by the way, it's because of the implementation that we are where we are at the moment, for the moment. Assuming they are not there, improved, it would have been worse. So the issue, there are three issues that limit policy or legal implementation. The first one, which is across the board, is financing implementation of the policy or execution of the laws. It's very important that aspect is met adequately. And I've looked at not only those in the environment sector in general, but also other sectors, what limits achieving the full outcome of the laws are how much resources are allocated for its attainment. And in the environment sector alone, we have that very big limitation. The second aspect is a public attitude who look at environmental resources as a common good and therefore for which they should not be regulated to access it, and they want to use it the way they would want to. So there's for a long time, there was attitude that resources down there are free access, anytime. And now when the regulators now go there to stop, then the public is ready to fight, to say you are interfering with our freedoms that have been entrenched on us, that have been entrenched for a long time, and you're just coming in to interfere with it. So that alone is another thing that I think prevents policy framework. If you compare it to other countries, once a legislation is passed by parliament and assented to by the head of state, it is usually very well appreciated by the public. So its implementation becomes very easy. Here, you start from the negative to go to the positive to explain a lot of other things. The third aspect, I think, which probably limits which is limiting the implementation of policies, is it's understanding policy, the publics for which the policy is intended to. Different publics understand different. So You see, if you go for us to work up the rural areas, the laws are in English, the words are whatever, so you have to first start from there. Mm.
Exactly, that's what I wanted to ask you, that you point at public attitude, but have there efforts that have been made, probably to create civic awareness, because sometimes you might have very good laws and policies in place, but probably as a layperson, I might not understand the need for...
I agree with you. That is basically the main problem with all the laws in Uganda. You need to spend money, especially environmental laws, we need to spend money to explain to people the law, because there are so many clauses in the law. This aspect of the lawyers or the general thing that the ignorance of the law is no defense, there are so many people who are ignorant. And ignorance is not from the rural people, but from people like you and me who are ignorant about the laws that are passed. So the first policy intervention and legal intervention will be public awareness and public education. Educate people on how that is done. And I think the first aspect of the National Environment Act that was done very well, because it had an oil to facilitate it, to go around to all villages, explain civic opinion leaders everywhere. It was done and people understood. That's why, like for my institution, NEMA is a brand name. You go to the villages, people know about it. But because they know about it from the first, that was done. But we needed to sustain it. Sustaining that, because new laws are coming. Right now we have the National Environment Act 2019. We need to get out down there to explain this law to all people. But we are, as I told you, one of the driving factors that limits us is how much resources that we get to go to the people. Even if we use, and you know, my experience with these laws, public touch with the people, you send a message more easily than you printing on the newspapers, nobody reads it on radios, people can listen to it and pass. But where you have engaged with people, even when we are doing restoration work or when we are trying to evict people, when we engage with them more, they will understand what they are doing is not correct, and why they should do it. And it's just like that. That's all that's needed. But I think we still have to really argue for enough resources and across board, so that we can go down there to explain. Because you have to buy in. That public, if the public buys in, and where the public has bought in the issues of the law, you have no problem.
Maybe sometimes the public buys in, but as government, there are lots of inconsistencies. I know it's sounding more like rhetoric, and when we talk about circumstances where the government has deliberately fail to reprimand people that encroach on the environment. There are cases where environment has been given away or sacrificed at the altar of commercial production. Yet, on the other hand, you're telling someone that you're not supposed to be building a two-rooms house in the wetland.
So, well, that, of course, is a main accusation that people have come. So you come and squeeze us who are small, then you allow a bigger person to come in, like in form of industry. That's what you're saying?
Yes. Is it an accusation or is it a reality?
I think...
And probably that is where the problem is coming from.
No. It's an accusation because, first of all, if you look at the numbers that we have, we look at the change in land use. The largest loss of, for instance, wetlands, is in the Kyoga Basin between 1994 and 2018. We lost 85% of the wetlands in Kyoga. To what? Not to infrastructure, to people, agriculture. People going there to look that they can grow mainly rice, do other things and whatever. So they don't settle there. So it's not true that when you see one factory here located there, then you say, that's the main people. But yes, when you look at the development pathway that the country has been following, well, that's where we are trying to focus on industrialization. And you know, one of the attempts of that is the conversion of Namanve Forest into an industrial park. Try to bring people where there is land. We have land use, inherent land use challenges in the country. You know it. So that limits government to access land from people. like the way other countries do, where if they want an industrial park, they will just establish one and it's done. Here you have to buy, and buying it is not cheap. So, and then we are attracting investors. My institution part of those to bring the investors in. However, in Mbamba Industrial Park, now we have also the one in Biogere Industrial Park, we have the one in Luzira Industrial Park. Then districts themselves have decided to create industrial parks, try to get some money. But there are several industrial parks by UIA which have been created all over. But the gist of the interest that most of the developers, those who bring money, don't want to go to Kasese. They tell you Kasese doesn't have power, constant power. Or Gulu, or Soroti, or those which have that, doesn't have constant power. I want it here. So some sections of the wetlands to be allocated for industrial use, and that has occurred particularly if you go to Mbalala in Mukono and whatever. But there, the local government decided to create an industrial park at themselves, and that's happened there. But the if you look at the quantity of land that has been consumed by industrial conservation compared to what peasants have taken more of these conversions, more. But also, if you look at the what you call the outcome, you know, people need employment. I mean, if you look at, let's not shy it out. Employment, because if you go to Namav Industrial Park now, the number of people employed there, if you go to the one, if you go to Mukono, if you go to that one in the evening, how many young people are walking on the road going to work there? So, but now what we do, we also classify our wetlands. Our wetlands are classified into those which are red, no-go area.
For example?
But if you go there, we are going to get you out. And if you go to Nakivu wetland down there, if you've seen for the last 10 years or so, people have tried to go in, we have got them out. Quite a lot of it. So a lot, but the people who have gone there are now still peasants. Sometimes it's for the same reason they're saying that you get these guys out. But Nakivu wetland, all these big wetlands that are infringing Lake Victoria are very important breathers and whatever. So there we say class red. That means no-go area. There are those which we call class B, which can be utilized for other purposes. Then class C are these small ones which convert themselves from floodplains to wetlands. And that is where you look at the industrial parks, the industries that we have approved along Gulu Road after Matuga, down there. On the sections there, the most of them, if you trace, they have actually not fully converted them into wetlands. They are still on the verge of floodplains. So that's where we have allocated them. So that is the categorization that we have, again, to address this issue of pressures. Now, the other aspect that we do is that when an industry gets into a place, so many conditions are imposed on them, the do's and don'ts. That you can use this, you can use this, you cannot use this. You can do this, you can do this. And those who have complied have continued. Those who have not complied, we have got them out. Mm. They are not complying to the.
But we are yet to hear stories of those that have not complied and you've got.
There are so many. By the way, because of the vigilance, the most compliant group of sector, the most compliant sector to the environment is the industry, industrial sector. If you look at it, because once you comply with the environment, you are complying with the profits as well. That's all. Because we already demonstrated Nile breweries, Uganda breweries, always used to pump their waste into River Nile, into Lake Victoria. But we gave them time, said from here, no, we're going to close your brewery.
But Doctor, you talked about financing, execution, and public attitude as the impediment to, as a major impediments to legal and policy frameworks. But there is a feeling that our laws and our policies are more conservationist than restoration. What's your take on this?
No, the I've given you the environment policies allow for you. You see, first of all, the conservation aspect is all that you desire, that let it be like what it was. But then we allow development through conditions. Okay, that's why you come to NEMA. We say we allow you to develop there on the condition that you do A, B, C, D, so that you do your development, then the conservation perspective still remains. You don't generate your waste that is going to kill this other part. You don't do this. So that's the theme of our regulation, to allow people to utilize the resources under condition that we don't compromise the productivity of the system for the present, but trying to do it also for the future. So pursuing the aspect of sustainable development. The regulation that we have on any industry that we have, there's so many industries that we have come here, is based on that. So not conservationists. Conservation areas are known. The conservation agencies are National Forest Authority or Wildlife Authority. They do conservation, no touch, completely nothing. Here, we regulate. Even in the park, we go there to say, this activity, we're going to allow it under conditions, the ABCD. Because the parks need to have where the tourists go and rest, but you just don't build them anywhere. That come, they have to regulate. So we have, even within the conservation agencies, where there are other things that we can approve. For instance, we have approved oil mining, the drilling of oil, extraction of oil from Maxion National Park, and from Queen Elizabeth National Park, because we've gone there. But under which conditions? Because the conservation says we need to continue the conservation, but get your oil. That is where we come in.
But exactly. That's probably what I'm trying to bring out. What seems to be lacking is the aspect of restoration. I'll give you an example. Our legislation and policy talks about not deforesting. And if, in case you're to cut a tree, you should. You should replace it with five more trees. But what has been done as people go ahead to plant eucalyptus and then pine, but between me and you, we both know there is no conservation with planting pine. And probably what the public needs from you there is, how then do you come in as an authority to ensure that there is also restoration on the other areas that have been encroached on or degraded?
You see, this is a very good question, because now if you look at the development that are there, the average Ugandan, you want to plant trees for money. You are not planting them for conservation. That is why we give you to go and plant your pine. But if you are going to plant trees in a forest reserve and whatever, we want you to plant indigenous trees and whatever. So planting pines, planting whatever, is plantation trees. We need timber. It is to reduce pressure on the natural forest. So if we can give you timber from softwood and hardwood outside the natural forest by planting like this, then we reduce pressure on the natural forest. That is just a strategy. But if you look at all tropical countries, whatever, people are going for natural forest trees which are 500 years old, whatever, to cut. Now we're saying, no, we encourage you to plant trees so that we discourage you from cutting the natural forest. That's the strategy that's there. Now, there are trees at home, and there are trees at home, and the National Forest Act, the Tree Planting Act, divides forests into three categories. There are forests which are under central government for conservation. Those are under central government. Those are national forest reserves under National Forest Authority. Those are a few. Then there are forests under the district local government. Now, those ones, you can't see them now, because each cycle of each coming political cycle, the guys want to see where is the tree. And so that is where the biggest loss of forests has occurred, the district local government, the forests under district local government. Then there are forests under private. People are private. Private people, some are, if you go to Kalangala, there are some people own forests and they don't want to cut them.
So if the biggest challenge is at the local government, do you think there is anything that should be done at that level?
Yes.
Should then the authority of controlling forests and environment at the local government be centralized, or there is need to be more enforcement at the local government?
Given that the general trend in the entire country is that all the forests under local government have been lost. The decline in forest cover in Uganda is as a result of loss of forestry in this, under this local government. That means that the laws, the way the law is articulated there, has disabled the authority, the officers, the technicals, to prevent loss of that. So there is a thinking to review the law. Because before this thing was broken, it was under Forest Department. All the trees were under the central government, and the forests were there. But they thought under the centralization regime, we needed to provide some option for this. So that's what happened. So I think there's a thinking towards that process now. Because again, we need to bring those forests back. Not only that, the forest reserves, you may just go there and say, this is a forest reserve, there's no tree. So soon also the land will be lost also. So this also is a big challenge.
So you might go with your trees and don't find the land.
But we know where they are. My colleagues who are responsible for forests know where the forests are. They are opening boundaries. Now we encourage now planting plantation forests there. That's why we want you, private people, to go and plant in those places down there so that we can get something. Because once it comes under private, you know, it becomes a property.
Yeah. Doctor, we cannot shy away from the fact that one of the biggest challenges to environmental conservation in this country is circumvention of laws, especially by the powerful, influence peddling. I want to dig into what has it been like 9 years for you at the helm of NEMA under those challenges or under the circumstances.
Yeah, you said a very interesting thing. You know, influence peddling, circumventing the law by the public, those in authority. I've managed the environment. I mean, I've been in charge of the environment authority for 9 years. And one of the things that I've never got or an instruction from those in powerful authority to instruct me how to do my work. Or to do wrong, do like this. No. So I've steered this clear, and I've advised whoever has been informing that is, whether minister or whatever, that do say, no, this the law says I do like this. Okay? Now, that comes at a certain level. Again, most of those influence peddling and which has affected the environment, especially like the forest sector, takes place at the district local government. The local government chairman, five, whatever. And you see, because the officials of the civil servants in the districts are decentralized, okay? They're decentralized, they belong to the district. So if the political head of the district is going on the wrong side, and you, the civil servant, is here, your protection level is very small. You know, in the main public service, the protection level is big. So you'll find that these guys are quickly acquired, so they keep quiet. Or if they make noise, they say they can even be dismissed from work. Some of them a few cases of that have occurred. So it occurs at that level, but also wrongly so. One of the challenges that we have, and I think you've collected, say that if because managing the environment is again a decentralized function, if at the local centers, at the district level, and we have some districts, by the way, like Moyo, in the north, which the political level has bought in the environment. You enjoy it, and everybody is enjoying. They are enjoying the fruits of that kind of thing. But there are some districts where that's not seen, and so when there's a project of road making, and they have to, you know, when they make roads, they have to dig borrow pits. In our law, you have to get permission from that. After you get borrow pits, you have to restore. And who controls some of the local contracts there are owned by people around there. So it's just that kind of thing. At central government, we go for them. We go for those who peddle influence. We don't have any qualms. We've taken people to court. We have removed them from their places. Honorable Nyakana, we removed his house. There are many who have left, who have removed from there.
But it's good you've brought it up. There is an interesting element in the story of Mr. Nyakana. The public seem to be siding with, sympathizing with his eviction. What influences this?
Who's that public?
The public who are also participating in doing the wrong things there. Because they saw removing Nyakana, or when Nyakana opened the gate for them to...
It was a floodgate for them to also...
to get out.
Okay.
To get out. So that's what happened. But he's been quite... Subsequently, we were working together. He's a political leader of the city, quite well doing that.
You seem to be saying there hasn't been influence peddling, but I would say that the public largely believes, for example, you are the challenge at the giveaway of, at the loss of Bugoma Forest to sugarcane growing.
Why should the public bring us at the center of Bugoma? Actually, it's a very interesting thing. That one, I like it. One, the government of Uganda, under the restitution of the Restored Kingdom, in 2013, started from 2011, 2013, 20 whatever, gave back the land to the Mukama. And the process is there, documented. Attorney General, this is a land. Solicitor General say, that's your land, use it the way you want it. Uganda Land Commission says, please issue. Minister of Lands issues a lease offer, a title to the king. So let's start from there. So that transfer was gone through the restitution of properties of what?
Of cultural institutions.
So it was done by the other government officials, not NEMA. Now the public wants us, we are at the tail end. They want us to be the ones to stop the water.
They thought probably the environmental impact assessment report would be the safeguard, that it was the only remaining gatekeeper to giving
no.
away.
You see, that's where the difference comes in. And I think in the process of assessing environmental impact assessment, what do we do in environmental impact assessment? It's a procedure. When you come, you say, okay, this is my property. The first thing we did with the Bugoma Forest, with the Hoima Sugar, when they came first in 2016, said, no, there's a problem, there's a court issue here, so we can't handle it. So first finish your court issues. They said, okay, wait. They went to court, High Court of Uganda, and they won the case. We were not party to that. Our colleagues who own the forest appealed for a stay of execution of the order. That was also lost in the court of what?
That was NFA.
NFA. Mm. So you see the process. The other part of government gave, these guys went to court, they lost. So in our view, we can't interfere with the court process. We can't say the court was wrong. The people are now drumming for this, say the forest made a mistake. The judges made a mistake. They did whatever. So for us, we don't do that. We're part of government. So what's the legal thing? Now, you have won all the cases. We have tried to hold you
at bay,
hoping that those processes will hold you. They didn't hold. The man said, now what reason do you have? I am an investor now. Now we turn to developers. I'm an investor. I have my land. And we have also followed this process. We have a record. We can't say that Hoima Sugar is not the owner of the land. Hoima Sugar leased the land from the king. The king is the owner of the land. He's a landlord. He's the king. He's a landlord. Omukama is the landlord of that land. He has just leased land to Hoima Sugar for the purpose of it. Now, Hoima Sugar presents us their proposal of what they want to do in that land. That is how NEMA now comes in. We cannot go to the issues of land. That's not our jurisdiction. We are now looking at regulating what Hoima Sugar wants to do, like we do any other thing. So Hoima Sugar has come. They made a proposal. We have undergone. We first did ask them to do a detailed study. They did a study. In that study, we were able to know where this land is, what is there, what type of tree species are there, where and how much is actually having trees. Because you may talk, like I told you, the forests in the districts, They are there, but if you go, like you, you never see that, because there are no trees. But it's just Maxton say this is a forest reserve. So also, how much of that land, which the king had it, was still what? Forest. So that is how we are saying. So when we went there, we found out that actually nearly a quarter of the land had not, it was made.
Doctor, we are going for a break, but I mean, if it was only 3/4 that had remained, does that give anyone the leeway to even raise the 3/4 that had remained?
No, I'm going to explain to you what it means. But I'm just saying, we have seized as NEMA, the issue of ownership has ceased to be an issue. Well, the issue now at hand is to regulate the proposal by the investor. That's where we are.
Okay, Doctor, let's go for a very short break.